Okay, and then I know I got to take off. You probably do too. You know, just final advice. You know, to somebody trying to get into the business. I'm going to try to get in. So you know, just your chance to give them your 3-5 minute infomercial of encouragement. You know, just inspire them. You know, here's your moment to.
Okay.
Without music, sorry.
Right, I'm sorry.
Without a guitar playing.
A lot of it's going to sound the same, so forgive me if I'm redundant in any manner.
That means you're focused. You know what you're talking about.
Yeah, so
okay.
It is what it is. So, but anyway, any advice that I would give to any new individual, young or old, that wants to get involved with the music business or the music industry, first and foremost, I would say, why are you doing what you're doing? If it is to make money, then I think I would have you rethink this particular industry. You can go out and make money doing something else. However, if you find that this is now, that is not to say that if you know that you're great with technology and you're great with those types of things and you want to get in the music industry, that's a different story. Now we're talking about the artist, the person that wants to be a performer or a writer. I mean, like I said, not to be a sales pitch, but one of the things we're trying to do with Rock and Load University is to, present kind of like, prerequisites for college, give you all a big synopsis of all the different things involved with music. It's not just about one thing, it's an industry. So I'm trying to qualify that. So if you're, in other words, coming to get involved with the music industry as a writer, performer, that sort of thing, the first thing I would always say is to find your influences. And learn those influences. Learn those songs so well that you can sit on a table or in a bar stool or any place else and perform each or any one of those songs that you claim to be an influence. Because I think that's so important to have embedded in your life, in your spirit, all those people that influence your life. Because that's going to come out when you start writing. When you start writing, you're going to be thinking melodic structures, you're going to be naturally doing things that you don't realize that you're doing, but those were the influences of your life coming out. It's like a spiritual thing. I don't want to get weird on anybody, but it really is. All those influences just take a natural course and they come out. They just happen. So learn as much as possible. Surround yourself with greatness. Surround yourself with people that are way beyond your means or your talents and abilities, but are a place where you want to go. I wouldn't settle for that, and I wouldn't let anybody cater or pander. And say, man, well, that was great. Now, I'm not saying, be hurtful or anything of that nature, but just be realistic with your work. There again, you have to have a foundation. So that's why I reiterate the most important thing is to find out who your influences are, because you can always A-B what you're doing with what they're doing. Are you writing a song as good as Blackbird? Are you writing a song as good as, whatever your influences is, because that's your plumb line, okay? I mean, now, if you're trying to get a cut, look at what's being current. You do have to be current. You don't want to write these 15-minute songs when radio's playing 3.5-minute songs. I mean, so there are the realities and the dynamics of what needs to be done. You have to be a commodity. You have to be sellable. You have to be able to make something, something that someone else wants to have and can market. But there again, go through the process again. Find out who your resources are, who your influences are. Try to emulate them as much as possible because they become the foundation, the seeds that have been planted that hopefully will grow as you go. The second thing is to perform as much as possible. Whether you're a writer or a performer, go out and sing, go out and write, go out and perform. Do these things as much as possible. Why? Because now you're placed amongst your peers. You're being looked at by the public. Now, other songwriters, there again, you can care or not care whether what they say, but I think they're a community of their own. They're very supportive, and they will give you honest feedback. Man, I love that, or I don't like that, or this or that, and I think that's good too. But more importantly, it gets back to the performance again. If you are constantly performing in front of these people, you are getting better at that skill. You're able to perform, you're able to play, you're able to read a crowd. You're able to say, well, I better not do this song right now because I don't think it'll be received well right now. You can only do that by doing it so much. You got bands like Bon Jovi and people like that, or the Rolling Stones, I mean, they'd go out, for instance, not to, get off track, but, when they got through doing a record, what they would do is go into a club unannounced, whether it be Connecticut, wherever they are, and actually do multiple strings of shows to be able to see what songs of that set list worked well, because that became the sequence of events on that record. Because they can see the best pieces. And then from a live performance, they were able to see what songs moved. I mean, if you worked real hard all night long to get somebody to the dance floor, you would better keep them there. Why? Because if you kept them there, they got thirsty. That means they went to the bar and they started drinking. They started tipping the bar to keep. You know, they started, the clubs loved you. Great, these guys are making them dance, man. They're making them drink. So, you know, but today it's like, you know, yeah, I got some French fries between my teeth. And I just, you know, I mean, scratch that. Anyway, you know, it's not about you. It's about the audience. And I think the connection with the audience, so the more that you play out, you get to have this connection with the audience. You get to get your skill levels up, the physicality of it, but mentally you can be able to communicate. You know, my wife always gets mad at me. She said, Dan, you got your eyes closed all the time when you perform. The reason why I do that is because I can't look at anybody. It's hard for me. I have to find myself. I have to go to that place, and then I perform, and I can't open my eyes. Now, when I'm with the band, when I play with Kent or all those guys, that's a different story. That's a performance. That's a rock and roll guy, you know. But acoustically, it's a challenge, you know. And I think that's why, you know, I strongly urge people to go out and do it naked like that. There's nothing more naked than one voice and one guitar, you know. If you're a writer, learn an instrument. Learn an instrument. Take guitar lessons. And there again, I'll go all the way back again. Learn those records. Memorize those records. Because those records are foundational. And then grab a guitar, grab a piano, grab something that you can work with. Then what happens, even if you're limited as a player, those melodies and those structures that you've known so well will come out. You can take one chord, C. Relax, no, you'll turn off your mind, relax and float downstream, it is not I. You know, all in one key, C. I mean, that's it. You know, here's John Lennon writing all these songs, you know. Very simple, but took melodic structures way out, you know. And so, you know, I don't keep on harping on that, but learn as many songs as possible. Memorize those songs. Perform those songs. Hone in on your skills. Perform as much as possible. And then from there, I think what happens is that you find your own little market. You find your own little team of people that want to see you. And if you start doing that, say, and you're in Nashville, and from Nashville you go to Knoxville, and the same thing happens, well then now, wow, I've got two markets that I'm in, and the same things are happening, so I must be doing something right. Well then, now let's go down to Chattanooga. Now we're in Chattanooga, and wow, things are happening there. So I've got to do that. So now I've got three places that I can make a rotation, and I'm playing, and all of a sudden I'm building a region, right? And then from there, let's go into Alabama. Now, I mean, let's go down to Huntsville. We're there. You're doing the same thing. I think too many times people come to one particular city, they build that city up, and they don't go beyond that because they're waiting for someone, like you said earlier, to come to them and say, hey, I'm going to do this for you. Now, that might happen if they see that there's some sort of, you know, monetary value in that, but for the most part, none of that takes place. You know, that's not the reality of where we're at. And if it is, that's why we're in the problems, the state that we are in. It's because that's what we've done. There again, that's land stripping. You know, oh, we can make some money on that. You know, but are you really developing anything? You know, there again, it's okay. Everybody has their own viewpoint. McDonald's is good. Billions and billions and billions of dollars. But so is Ruth Chris. You know, so I just think that you have to pick and choose your battles. And for me, it's, you know, even the things that we're involved with, that's, you know, I would rather perform and sing, and you know, and if you, this, I guess that's the bottom line too. Even if you never obtain or reach those goals, you have a foundation by which you can be a plumber by day, but a singer-songwriter at night, and you're happy with yourself. You've got a peace about what you're doing. You're playing Chattanooga, you're playing Huntsville, you're playing wherever you're playing. You're playing Joe's Bar and Grill on a Friday night, you know. And I think if it was meant to go beyond that, then it will. But you were saying something earlier about being force-fed. Don't be force-fed. You know, just because society says, oh, we better force-feed this person through, you know, American Idol, or, you know, You Can Be a Star, or Nashville, you know, whatever. I mean, you know, that's great. But if you haven't been doing that up to that point, what good is it, really? What, are you going to start right then, maybe? And, you know, you're going to start from that point, and all of a sudden, hey, I'm going to memorize all these songs. No, at that point, it's a little too late, because everybody's going to try to shove their songs down your throat. And, you know, and all the publishers, hey, listen to my songs. And really, what have they done? I mean, really, they're just, you know, you could be listening to 60 songs, and every song is the same as the previous song that you heard. There's nothing new or unique about any of that. So that's why I'm saying you need to stay true to yourself, learn as much songs, many songs as possible, because you're going to learn the difference right away of what is a hit song and what is not. Instead of someone telling you that's a hit song, you're going to know intuitively that that's a hit song. So that way you're not going to be force-fed. You're not going to be sitting there and saying and shoved in a box and saying this is what radio has to do. Heck what radio. I don't care about radio. So, you know, we have to go back to that type of mentality. So that goes back to the independent person. Be who you are. And don't care about those things. If those things come, then great. Now, however, just the opposite. If those things are exactly what you want, do all the things, repeat from what I just said from earlier up to that point, and start making wise business decisions. Decide on who are the people that you think you can, you know, partner with in a business sense, and then have them outsource basically what you're doing. You know, and then take product to various markets and be a business person about it. And then from there, you know, find those local radio stations that would be willing to play your stuff. Find those local clubs that you can set up a little tour. Right. Set up, you know, these little radio stations that you can, you know, not only get your records played, but the music stores that would be willing to, you know, sell your records locally. It's not about the big corporate world anymore, you know. Find people who are good at social networking for you. You know, find people in your friendships that can help you with building websites, driving people to that website, you know, giving your music away for free. Why? So they can hear it. Why? Because when you go to their town, you want them to come to see you. Well, now you're charging them $20, right? And you get 500 people. That's how much? I don't know. That's $10,000, just in case you didn't know. But I mean, that's a lot of money, you know. So I'm just saying that's where the money's at today. And I think that's longevity. And I think that's what bands need to do. And there again, it's just reverting back to what we've always done, although we've kind of skipped a couple generations of people who've had to do that. You know, that's an unfair statement. I don't mean that. You've got like Green Day and all these phenomenal. I love Green Day, you know, I'm still part of a punk movement, but I mean, you know, I love bands like that. You know, like they got the courage. You know, I was gonna say balls, but I mean, you know, they got the testosterone to like jump in their little vans and take off. You know, it's like Paramore or some of these other bands, and they just jump in and go. That's what I like to see. I mean, I love that. You know, that's what rock and roll and music's all about. You know, that's Loretta Lynn, right? It's no different, except that was 50 years ago or 40, whatever, how long ago, and versus now. You know, right now people want to go directly to radio, directly to television, directly to this without any skill set whatsoever. You can't do that without any long, you know, with expecting any long-term sustainability. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. No matter what anybody tells you, it's not going to happen. I mean, just look at, you know, I'm not trying to be offensive again. I mean, I'm just look at what from American Idol has any sustainability. You know, that's what I'm talking about. You know, they were plunged into 25 million people. They were huge for a couple weeks. I don't hear of any of them now. I mean, I personally don't. But it shouldn't matter anyway. That's the whole point. I mean, you know, get in your little van, pick up a bunch of little clubs. I've got a friend right now, you know, and her husband, that's what they do. I mean, yeah, it'd be nice to make $1 million in this and that, but they're sustaining themselves. They go all over Florida. They go all over the country. They sell, you know, several hundred records. I mean, you know, if they sell a few thousand records, that's great. It paid for their trip and their eats and all that kind of stuff. I mean, they're doing it for the right reasons, you know, and I think that we all have to be willing to do that. If you're willing to do that, then whatever comes is going to be a blessing anyway. So I think if we have that mindset, you know, that because, like again, it goes back all the way I was saying about Chris Young or myself or other people that could go back that far. You knew when you were 7, 8, 9, 10 what you were supposed to be doing anyway. So and you weren't thinking about, man, I'm going to be a star, or man, I'm going to be making money, or man, you were just thinking, wow, I can see how this makes me, you know, it moves me. You know, it's a very personal thing. And then all of a sudden you notice how that same movement moves others. Because it's about you, from that perspective, in a purest of senses. If it touches you, and you are passionate about what you're doing, others are going to pick up on that passion. And guess what? You're going to stir that passion in them. They become a fan. They buy your records or products, whatever it is that they're trying to get involved with. Radio doesn't do that. For, you know, Sorry.
No, you were good. You were good.
Anyway, but those are all the things that I would suggest to you know, folks that are trying to get involved with the business. Money is not the first thing that you should think of. There again, think of why I'm doing what I'm doing. Decide on what my desired outcome is, and if it's just to be able to do what I feel I was born to do, and I mean literally, then that, if that's the case, then you should be able to do that in your backyard or any place that you want to, and doesn't have to be in front of a stadium with 50,000 people. So that's the outcome of being passionate. So so the rest of it doesn't matter. Anyway, signing off.
Rock on. Thanks, Dan. Awesome, brother. Thank you, man. Appreciate it.
Yep.
No. Actually, I think we, you know, the nice thing is when I've got more